We gather as a community.
Again and
confess with gratitude because we know that God already has heard and forgiven us. No matter what we have done or left undone, we are held in God's hand. So rest in this good news. God invites us in. God meets us where we are. God hears our prayers. God forgives us. Thanks be to God for a love like that. As a forgiven and reconciled people, let us give thanks and share a sign of Christ's peace with those around us. If you're joining us online, we invite you to share the peace in the comments. And for those of us in the sanctuary, please take a moment and greet your neighbors. Feel free to stand up and move around. May the peace of Christ be with you.
Reclaiming our tears is central to a life of faith.
because our tears nurture vulnerability and connection and foster both personal and collective healing. That will be in this room at 12:45. So get some coffee and a cookie and then come back and find us here. We're so grateful that this book talk is co-sponsored by Greenlight Books. There are a few other announcements in your bulletin, so please take a look at what other opportunities for connection and action are coming up. With that, let us continue to worship God. Melody, falling off our lips like a love song, We are listening. Amen.
Amen.
Today's reading is from Exodus chapter 20, verses 1 through 17. Then God spoke all these words, I am the Lord, your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above, or that is on the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or serve them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing children for the iniquity of parents to the third and fourth generation of those who reject me, but showing steadfast love to the thousandth generation of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. You shall not do any work, you, your son or your daughter, your male or female slave, your livestock, or the alien resident in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made the heaven and earth, the sea, and all that is in them, but rested the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and consecrated it. Honor your father and your mother, so that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, male or female slave, ox, donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
May the words of my mouth So I am morbidly obsessed with this evangelical fundamentalist show called The Hard In Podcast. No, I don't think its creator has any idea how delightfully homoerotic that sounds. The show itself is absolute hot garbage, but it's like this car crash I can't get away from. They like to say things, again, without a hint of irony, like, "Men, stop neutering yourselves. You are made for mission, marriage, and fruitfulness. You are made to father an army of God-fearing children. Be fruitful, multiply, and subdue the earth." Just quite a lot going on there. It's wild to me that someone can read Jesus' words, go, and then say something like, "Undisciplined children are generally not blessings, but curses." It's a curious hermeneutic, to be sure. I bring these delightful fellows up today because today's lectionary is, at points, one of those maddening scriptures that makes you want to ask Paul if he didn't have a little more repentance to do on the road to Damascus. If you're here waiting for me to redeem verses like "Christ crucified as a stumbling block to Jews," I'm going to keep you waiting. Obviously, these words are written in the middle of an intense moment of division and schism within Judaism, where members of the New Jesus movement were carving identity for themselves as Christians, making theological claims that deviated from the history of Jewish interpretation, navigating the ensuing fallout. And still, it is inescapable that words like these have been used by folks who use the Bible as an anti-Semitic cudgel, and I will not apologize for wishing that Paul had simply left them out, because folks like our hard-men friends don't need any more weapons. And it's doubly frustrating because the rest of these verses cut straight to something incredibly important. The way that divine vulnerability is often portrayed as weakness. The way that God's wisdom is called foolishness by folks who worship death, not resurrection. And I get so frustrated that the Bible carries verses that lead people, if we're going to be real honest, men in particular, to say things like, "Women should understand that submission is a muscle. The more you use it, the easier it is to exercise." Because they have let a couple of stray verses warp their understanding of a broader biblical canon that is deeply concerned with how everyone, men, women, and all the folks beyond those genders, how all of us should nurture humility, softness, and vulnerability. But honestly, I bring up these hard men TM, and I swear this is the last time I'm going to mention them, because I think many of us still carry this reflexive cultural understanding of what it means to be strong, albeit in less exaggerated and ridiculous forms. I'll give you an example. Last year, I published a book about crying. I've been on a tour of communities, radio, news, etc., to talk about the importance of softness and tears. Shameless plug to stick around after worship. I'm so excited to talk with you about the link between tears and resurrection. But anyways, here I am. I've written this book all about why vulnerability is essential, talking about how I learned to cry again, how tears connect us to our neighbors, how they lead to transformation. And then in the middle of the interview, I'll start crying, and often the first thing that I do, reflexively and without thinking, is begin to apologize for my weeping. We may not go around saying ridiculous things like, "Men, stop neutering yourselves," but American culture has equated strength with individualism and unfeeling toughness for so long that this lie lives in our bodies. Even if we've done the work, we've gone to therapy, we've done the reading, a moment will come, perhaps when someone around us needs help, and we will instinctively think, "Why can't that person just do it for themselves?" Or, perhaps more common, we will recognize our own failures, our own need for others' support, and be crueler to ourselves than anything we would ever say to another person. But what we see in this letter is Paul saying that Christ's death and resurrection, the central story of our faith, physically embodies God's commitment to a different kind of logic, one which understands that vulnerable love is stronger than physical violence could ever be. We proclaim Christ crucified, Paul writes, noting that this sure looks like foolishness to anyone invested in worldly definitions of power. Particularly at that point in history, the general theological understanding was that the relative power of various gods was sorted by war and conquest. That's why when Rome would conquer a new province, they would have to begin offering sacrifices to Caesar. It's why King Herod put a giant Roman eagle on the entrance to the temple, a literal symbol to make it clear whose God was in charge. And here are these new followers of the way who openly confess, "You crucified our Lord. You hung him on a hill to die. You buried him in a tomb, but he is not there. He is risen." We worship a God who cannot be contained by the cross. There is a love more powerful than anything you can kill. It is a proclamation that matches the very life of Jesus, the way he brought chronically ill and disabled people into the center of his ministry, the way he defined God's love by its willingness to transgress borders and boundaries, all the ways that countries delineate who is deserving of care and who is not. The way he, when asked, "Who is the greatest in the kingdom of God?" brought children before them, little ones who had almost zero power in the ancient world. The way he lifted up those children to say, "This is what it looks like. Be filled with the vulnerable love of God. Go and be like children." It was a countercultural message then, and it is a countercultural message now. And Paul is correct in his observation that human wisdom will look on this and call it foolishness. The veneration of God's power in the moment that Jesus is seemingly most powerless is the scandal of the cross. But it's powerful because vulnerability nurtures connection. When we admit that we cannot do everything by ourselves, that we should not even want to, it invites us to build community that transcends what any of us are able to do alone. That's true for our own personal crises, but it's also true for broader social action. It's so tempting to believe that through our own will and ingenuity, we can ignite a revolution. This is foolishness. Acknowledging that is not self-negation or a lack of faith. It's just clear-eyed understanding of the magnitude of our crises and the change that we must foster in response. In truth, people in power deliberately inculcate this deluded ethos precisely because it sabotages collective action. Deprogramming depends on repeatedly admitting our own insufficiency, not because we are bad, but because no single person is enough. Cultivating vulnerability and softness is a potent tool in helping that intellectual understanding take up residence in our bodies. We need other people. Fundamentally, essentially. That is not or should not be a radical statement. And yet, with the rise of entrepreneurial culture, hustle culture, grind culture, whatever words you want to use to describe it, we are fed a relentless diet of messages that all we need to do in order to succeed is work a little harder. Double down a little bit more. Show everyone you're strong. That whispering voice tells us, exert your will upon the world. Meanwhile, Paul speaks softly in the background. God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom. We need each other. And we need God. Not in a, those people don't believe in Jesus and they need to convert and be saved kind of way, but in honest admission that we are simply not able to move through the hardships and challenges of this life without a spiritual foundation. In a, I need Jesus, I'm not going to make it through kind of way. We may be able to survive, but God wants more for us than that. When we open ourselves to the resurrecting power of God's love, when we admit that we simply cannot make it on our own, God meets us in that vulnerable place and tells us this does not signify any kind of personal failure. It is the very best of what it means to be human. It's an invitation to life suffused by gratitude and wonder. But listen. We talk about a particular kind of vulnerability a lot. The kind that opens itself up to other people. The kind that sparks connection. The kind that reaches outward to cultivate community. But there's another kind of vulnerability we don't talk about as much. And it's one that is equally important. Tenderness with self. When we're in the middle of whatever mess we are pushing through. Maybe it's the ending of a relationship. Maybe it's struggling with mental illness or battling addiction. Maybe it's sorting through the wreckage that a traumatic experience has left aching in your body. I don't know. But I know that statistically somebody in this room is going through it right now, bringing all the care that they can muster for themselves in the middle of an incredibly difficult moment. And if that's you, I want you to know that that kind of love matters just as much as tenderness you can offer another person. There is an incredible vulnerability in admitting that something about the way I have been living is not working. That I need to change my life. There is a bravery and triumph in that act that the world might categorize as weak. And if that's you, God sees you. Moves you, and God loves you. And please, if you can, open that circle a little wider to invite someone in beside you. We do not have to travel the hardest roads alone. God chose what is weak in the world, Paul writes, to shame those who do not understand how deeply we need that mutuality. God chose what was low and despised, he continues, not only because God promises a world where the last shall be first, but because he is those very same qualities that the world has denigrated, which promised to lead us from this wilderness. In vulnerability, we are made strong. In God's foolishness, we are made wise. In asking for help to meet us in our broken places, we are finally made.
Yeah.
us that the earth is the Lord's, and all that is in it. The world and those who hold live in it. The blessings of life and breath, friendship and financial resources come from God. In that spirit, we thank you for your own gifts of generosity, which support the ministries of Lafayette Avenue Presbyterian Church. Gifts can be made by scanning the QR code on the inside back cover of your bulletin or in the offering plates. In gratitude for what we have been given, let us share our gifts.
is at this table Christ led his greatest act among the living, knowing what lay before him, knowing his betrayal, knowing his death. He came to be at a table with his friends, to invite them into that moment beside him, to admit that in that crucial pivotal moment, he could not be alone.
We come in strength the world calls weakness, willing to ask for what we need. We admit we need you to be whole, but this spiritual hunger does not make us broken. We come with longing to find abundant life.
Let us pray. God, as we come around this table, we know that we are living in a world filled with so many kinds of hunger. Physical hunger, of poverty and homelessness. Migrants in our community who have been shipped here without care and love. For all the folks who grow up not knowing the kind of tenderness that should be every human's birthright. We pray for everyone who knows physical hunger, those who suffer from war, particularly mindful of the violence in Gaza, in the Congo, in all the places, the broken places, where God's love has been submerged by violence. God, be that grace that moves through whispering and promising something different. A life guided by gentleness. One in which we and others can be fed. Lord, we pray for all who suffer from spiritual loneliness and isolation, and depression, fear, and anxiety. Lord, we live in painful, heartbreaking times, submerged by forces that would pull us from one another. Remind us at this table that we are always called to make our own a little wider, to pull up another chair, to invite someone in beside us, and to ask for a place at someone else's table, and we ourselves find ourselves alone. We give you thanks for these great gifts, for the opportunity you give to celebrate them. We join our voices for the people on earth and all come to you in heaven, singing praise to you.
broken. Saying, take, eat. This is my body, broken for you. And when the meal is done, Jesus took the cup. He poured wine. He said, this is my blood, shed for you. A new covenant for the forgiveness of sins, led for a new world. Friends, when we eat this bread, we drink this cup, do so in remembrance of me. And I will be with you until I come back. I invite you to participate in communion with us. You'll be standing in front of the cup. You can come up and dip the bread into the cup. Or if it's easier for you to receive communion where you're seated, please raise your hand and a deacon will come and offer communion to you.
Thank you.
way to the world, vulnerable, risk confrontation with humanity, risk exposure to the kind of love that changes you.